There's a few questions. I'm just going to quickly answer those. It says, last April, the Pope addressed the UN. Do you think he spoke first in French to acknowledge and commemorate the French Revolution, the St. Bartholomew Massacre, which slaughtered 50,000 Protestants? I already warned you that when you asked the questions, I could not guarantee a response. I don't know. I don't have a clue what language he's going to use. Do you know of the person named Al Cuppet? I'm 0-2. I have never heard of Al Cuppet. I think I live a sheltered life. It says he is talking about military secrets or installations that are being prepared for many, many people. What I do know, if that's what this gentleman is talking about, I know it mentioned last evening that there are camps, concentration camps, detention facilities, call it what you will, that are set up all over America. And they are set up for those that will oppose the papal New World Order. That's what they're set up for. And those dissenters, politically speaking, who will resist that in America. You know, I remember a story of a man, I don't remember, Hiram Dukes was his name. Hiram Dukes. Remember the name? He told a story of canvassing in Illinois. He came to one home. The man said, come on in, I want to show you something. So the man took him into a back room of his huge house, and he had all of these files. And he said, what did you say your name was? And he said, Hiram Dukes. The man went through his files and pulled out a file on Hiram Dukes. Folks, this man was a devout Catholic, and high-ranking Vatican officials, they know just about everything about us. Just about everything. They know our background, they know our religious affiliation, they know our likes and our dislikes. They make it their, what do we say? Their business, thank you. They make it their business to know as much about us as they possibly can. Why? Folks, they are absolutely determined to bring every single one of us and this entire planet into obeisance to them. They are hell-bent to do that. See, and they are so serious. They are so serious about this work that they are doing. And God has privileged us with an eternal treasure of the three angels' messages. And if we would get serious about our work and allow nothing to stand in the way of us sharing the three angels' messages with everybody we can. Folks, Nehemiah built the wall in 52 days. It happened very, very quickly. If we would get serious, if we would stop playing and realize the importance, the seriousness, the solemnity of what we've been given, if we realize that, this work could be done very, very quickly. Very quickly. And we could go home. We can go home. And receive our everlasting inheritance from the Abrahamic covenant. Revelation 17, verse 12. Let's take a look at that. Revelation 17 and verse 12. And it says it talks about 1 hour when judgment will come and riches will be lost. That's in Revelation 18, which we'll look at as well. Does this fit into last day events? What exactly does it mean, or is it important to us today? First off, Revelation 17, verse 12. It says, the ten kings which thou sawest are ten kings, the ten horns, excuse me, which have received no kingdom as yet, but received power as kings 1 hour with the beast. I don't think there's a lot of clarity among us as a people as to who the beast is. Number one, the beast, the woman sits on the beast. The woman is Babylon the Great. The woman is the papal system, Roman Catholicism. The beast, which has basically very similar characteristics as the woman, the beast, I believe, is the political power of the papacy. It's the papacy in its political part. Because Rome is not a religious entity by itself. It is a political religious entity. And I believe those two parts are brought out here in Revelation 17. The woman is the religious part of the papacy. The beast is the political part of the papacy. And the political part of the papacy is given to her by the governments of earth. The ten kings, Revelation 17, verse 12, which have received no kingdom as yet, I believe in the near future, as the world is divided up into regions, that we're going to have ten regions across this world. That's what I believe verse 12 is saying. And I believe that when that happens, there will simultaneously be a giving of all political power of the government's earth into the hands of Rome. Sunday laws will be passed both in America and worldwide. And for 1 hour, they will be allowed to completely dominate this earth in seeking to enforce worship of every inhabitant. 1 hour, prophetically speaking, is literally 15 days. That time period, I've heard it said it's 15 days or it's a very, very short period of time. When the papacy receives their political power one last time, folks, it's going to be for a very, very short time. And the reason why is because the papacy is going to come up against a power that they could never dream of. You see, in Malachi Martin's book, The Keys of This Blood, he says that the religious groups, the minority groups, he says, they're either going to be submerged in a new world order controlled by the papacy, or they're going to become smaller and smaller, and then they're going to disintegrate and disappear. You see, Malachi Martin was a authority, a Catholic authority. But you know, there's one thing that the papacy and Malachi Martin were not bargaining for. And the one thing that they don't realize that they're going to come face to face with very, very soon is Revelation 18 and verse 1. Revelation 18 and verse 1 says, after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. That's the latter rain. That's the loud cry of the fourth angel. And folk, the papacy and the powers of earth are going to come face to face with a small remnant of people. Amen. That are consumed. They are consumed with the power of heaven. They are consumed with the power of the third person of the Godhead. And they're not bargaining for that. They are going to come into mortal conflict, mortal battle with God's faithful children who are possessed by the Spirit of God. And in that titanic battle between all of these powers of earth, the religious systems, the governmental systems, the monetary systems, and all of the war implements, they will all come against this little group of people. But that little group of people are going to be unlike anything this world has ever seen. Because this world has never seen the power of the latter rain. They've never seen that. You say, well, they saw it at Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. Yeah, but that was a small measure of the Holy Spirit. Revelation 18, quote, Ellen White describes it. It was in my other talk. Ellen White describes it. She says, I saw that the latter rain is coming with 10 times the power of the midnight cry. And in Great Controversy, page 400, she says that the midnight cry went like a tidal wave across the land. So the latter rain is going to have the power, 10 times the power of a tidal wave. What stands in front of a tidal wave? Nothing. What stands in front of something that has 10 times the power of a tidal wave? Rome doesn't stand. The governments of earth don't stand. The religious systems of earth, the economic systems of earth, they will all come crashing down before the power of the latter rain. Praise God. Verse 13 says, these have one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. Ellen White in 7th Bible Commentary 7a, commenting on this verse, she says, there will be a universal bond of union, one great harmony throughout the world. Say, well, wait a minute, Bill, doesn't that contradict Daniel chapter 2? Folks, Daniel chapter 2 is looking at a historical period of time in which the Kaisers, in which Hitler, in which Charlemagne, through the dark ages and into modern times, tried to reunite Europe under one head. And they were looking to do that so it would carry on for a long period of time. Revelation 17 is talking about a very, very short period of time in which there will be unity throughout the earth. There will be, based on Revelation 17, verse 13, and the Spirit of God's comments on these verses. But they will come face to face with that small group of people. Revelation 17, 14 says, these shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. For he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful.
Amen.
You know, some of you asked during the last break if I would make mention of the current things going on with the new budget of $3.6 trillion, the fact that many see that we're heading towards socialism, the fact that many Republicans appear to be fighting it because they say, no, that's socialism, and we want to maintain a republic. Before I go on, let me just throw in, we're not a democracy. Does everybody understand that? A democracy is where the majority rules. That's a democracy. We are not a democracy. We're a republic. A republic is where law rules. The purpose for the Constitution and the Bill of Rights was to guarantee that no minorities would ever have their rights taken away. That was the point of the Bill of Rights. A democracy is mob rule. That's what it is. We're not a democracy.
Not yet.
Some people have asked about Barack Obama. Some people have said, you know, this thing didn't start with Obama, it started with Bush. You know, in my book, The Secret Terrorist, I quote a former Arizona governor who also, I believe, ran for either president or vice president of the United States, a man by the name of Barry Goldwater. Barry Goldwater wrote a book called With No Apologies. And in that book, he stated, it's page 278 and 279, he said that when a new administration comes into office, he said there is no change in policy, there's just a change in the people that are running. Folk, don't get bogged down in Republican, Democrat, Bush, Obama. Don't get bogged down in that. That's not the issue. It's not the issue. Revelation 17, and well, I'm not going to mention his name. Some people have criticized me because they say that I am just an absolute buffoon because I believe that the leaders of our world and the Bush family in particular were puppets of the papal system.
True.
Some of you are nodding your heads like maybe you read that. Okay. Folk, if it was simply my word, then you can call me whatever you want. And that would be fair. That would be absolutely fair. But when the Word of God, when the Word of God says something, then we better listen.
Amen.
The Word of God states the influence of rulers and kings and presidents in our world today. Let's read it. Revelation 17, verse 2. Revelation 17, verse 18. It's talking about the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, that all the reformers knew was the papacy. The only reason that most people don't know that today is because of the two Jesuit priests, Luis de Alcazar and Francisco Ribera, who stated that all the prophecies were either fulfilled in the past or all the prophecies remained to be fulfilled in the future. They took all the heat off of the real Antichrist in St. Peter's chair. That's why people don't understand who the great whore of the Mediterranean is in Revelation chapter 17. That's why. Verse 2 says, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. Well, who are the kings of the earth that have committed fornication with the papacy? Who are the kings?
The rulers.
The rulers, Gene. Now, what's another name for a ruler? Is a president a ruler?
Yes.
Time and Newsweek magazine, I believe, maybe it was Newsweek, stated that Barack Obama was the most powerful man on the face of the earth. I would say he's a ruler, wouldn't you?
Yes.
And George Bush before him was a ruler too, wasn't he? Now we call him presidents, but he was a king. A king. Not in the sense that he wore a crown, I'm not saying that, but he's a part of Revelation 17 and verse 2, isn't he?
Amen.
Now, Revelation 17 and verse 2 gives the idea that the kings of the earth, the rulers of the earth, and the papacy are on par. They're on par together. They're in an evil relationship together. But it gives the impression that they are equals. But Revelation 17 verse 18 paints an entirely different picture. Notice what it says. Revelation 17 verse 18. The Bible says, not Bill Hughes, the Bible says, the woman which thou sawest is that great city. So this apostate church that has the name of a great city in her name, Rome, Roman Catholic Church, it says that woman is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth. Now if you reign over somebody, who's in charge? The one who's reigning or the one who's being reigned over?
The one who's reigning.
The one who's reigning. I get the idea of somebody riding a horse. You're holding the reins. You rein in the horse. Who controls? The person who has the reins. Now, Revelation 17, verse 18 says that Babylon the Great, the papal system, reigns over the leaders of the earth. So who is telling Barack Obama what to do? Who controls the reins of the President of the United States? It's not Barack Obama. You say, Bill, now come on. Barack Obama is the first Afro-American president. Folks, this isn't about race.
Right.
Have mercy. It's not a race thing. Revelation 17, verse 18, it's not dealing with race. It's dealing with the one who controls the leaders of our world. That's the issue. Come on now. Let's not be narrow on this. Barack Obama is controlled by Rome. He's doing what Rome is telling him to do. How about George Bush? You say, maybe now, okay, I know what it is. Bill is saying that Barack Obama, because he's Republican. Bill is a Republican, and he doesn't like Barack Obama because he's a Democrat. That's what it is. Well, then let me ask you a question. What party was George Bush part of? He was a Republican. And who was pulling his strings, according to Revelation 17, verse 18? Rome was. So we have got to broaden our understanding here. We cannot look. We cannot look at what is going on in our country and in this world. We cannot look at it through our own eyes. If we do, we will be deceived. The only thing we can look through is through heaven's eyes.
Yes.
That is the only way. If we don't, we're blind to what's really happening. And we'll get caught up in Republican, Democrat, white, black, and all other kinds of things that are not the issue at all. According to Barry Goldwater, when a new person comes on board, there's a change in personnel, but no change in policies. Why? Because Rome has controlled Republicans and Democrats right on down for the last, who knows how many decades?
Yes, yes.
Who knows how many decades? Folks, we look at this economic situation. Folks, let's look at it through heaven's eyes.
Yes.
What if the papacy, as Revelation 17 says, controls the leaders of our world? If any of you listened to Barack Obama the other night and you watched as he spoke, right behind him, on one side was Joe Biden, a devout Roman Catholic. Did you know that? And on the other side was Nancy Pelosi. And you know what Nancy Pelosi? She was the first person, when she was brought in as Speaker of the House, to bring in a Jesuit priest to address the Houses of Congress. Why? Because Nancy Pelosi is controlled by her Jesuit mentors in San Francisco. Stephen Privet was his name. Folks, we've got to look through heaven's eyes. If we don't, we will be deceived. And Christ warned not once, not twice, not three, but four times in Matthew 24. He said, watch out. Don't let anyone deceive you.
Amen.
So if Rome excuse me, we've just been given a news flash. I'm sorry. Beautiful statement, Jackie. She said, we are pilgrims, not patriots.
Right.
Absolutely.
Amen.
This is not our home, folks. We've got to broaden our view of what's going on in the world. This is not our home. We're passing through. So, if Obama and Bush and Clinton and Bush and Reagan and Carter and Ford and Nixon and Johnson, if all of them are kings of the earth doing the bidding of the papacy, according to the Bible, where are all of earth's events heading headlong for? Where's it heading? As Seventh-day Adventists, we're the only ones that know where it's all heading. Where's it heading? It's called Sunday. That's where it's heading. You say, but wait a minute, why a crisis? Remember the last time I was here? We talked about George Friedrich Hegel, the thesis, antithesis, and synthesis. You have a problem, you create an antithesis, you create a conflict. And all the time that you're creating conflict, you've got the solution waiting. So when it gets bad enough and people are desperate enough, they'll start to say, what can we do to stop this crisis? What's the band-aid that's going to bring healing for what's going on? And when the world cries out, the papal spokespeople across the world are going to say, we've got to get back to God. We've got to get back to sound moral principles. You know, after the Obama speech the other night, a gentleman out of New York by the name of, I think it's Glenn Beck. He's a radio talk show host. My friend called me from Orlando. He said, turn on 580. He said, Glenn Beck is saying we've got to get back to a strong moral basis in America. And as an American, we would look at that and say, he's exactly right. Wouldn't we? That's the only answer, is to get back to a solid moral basis. But that's through our eyes. Who's behind Obama? Who's behind Glenn Beck? Who controls the airways? Who's telling us exactly what they want us to hear? According to Revelation 18, we already read it. The papacy controls the power elite, the bankers, the world's rich people. And the magazines and newspapers and television and radio people all work for Babylon the Great and the international bankers. So folk, unless we look at it through heaven's eyes, we're going to be deceived. All of this thing, Barack Obama takes it out this way, George Bush took it out to this extreme over here. And now these other people are going to come back and they're going to drive the pendulum way to the other side and say, these terrible things that are happening, it's because we are not moral, we're immoral, we're selfish, and we're greedy. We've got to get back to solid principles. And in Rome's ideas, what does that mean? To Rome, what does it mean to get back to God? To get back to solid moral principles? What does that mean? It means Sunday. See, folk, we've got to look through heaven's eyes. We've got to know what we believe, and we can't be bamboozled. We can't be tricked, folk. Our life depends on it. Our eternal destiny depends on it. If it didn't, Jesus wouldn't have warned four times in Matthew 24. Watch out. Don't let anybody trick you. He wouldn't have said that if he didn't know that at the end of time, deception would be running rampant. So all of these people are players. Bush was a player, Obama is a player, Biden is a player, Pelosi is a player. You say, that's disrespectful of our political leaders. Vote. Wait a minute, whose eyes are we going to look through now? Whose eyes? Heaven's eyes. Are they playing? They're playing. And who are they playing for? Are they playing for America? Are they playing for your benefit and my benefit? No. They're playing for their master's benefit, and their master sits in St. Peter's chair. That's who they're playing for. Not for you and not for me. Say, Bill, you're scaring me. It is scary. It is scary. Because we're reading in the book of Revelation that every entity in this earth that you can dream up is going to be united against us. That's scary, isn't it? Scary. I think after the first one, Jackie's getting overly confident, don't you? I'm just kidding.
What is this singer?
Dennis Prager? Prager. Conservative talk show host. I'm trusting you, Jackie. I haven't edited this. Says that no one can figure out why Democrats and Republicans are working together in these disastrous financial decisions. Does he know that most of them are Roman Catholics? Okay. I want to share a verse that we read last evening, and then I'm going to try to get to a few of the slides before we close. Nehemiah chapter 4. Nehemiah chapter 4.
Daddy.
Verse 14. Nehemiah said, I looked and rose up and said to the nobles and the rulers and to the rest of the people, be not ye afraid of them. Remember the Lord, which is great and terrible, and fight for your brethren, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your houses. Folks, this is a promise. This is a promise. Nehemiah said, don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord, who is great and terrible. Yeah. Folks, I'm going to tell you something. You can think whatever you want, and that's okay. But after reading some of the books that I have read about Rome's hate for Protestantism and for Seventh-day Adventism in particular, and after I've read things like Fox's Book of Martyrs and other things of that ilk, you come to realize how serious Rome is with what they are doing. And so when we mass mailed the town where I live, where they have a gigantic Catholic church right in the middle of the town with a huge statue of the Virgin Mary right there in the lawn, and we were mass mailing the secret terrorists to that town of about 8,000 homes, folk, I'll tell you, the battle that went on in my head that day, it was like I got up and I started my day. And I was heading out to the church to pick up the trays, to mass mail them all over the town with my book, one of the books I've written, The Secret Terrorist. And this voice kept pounding in my brain, don't do it, we're going to burn you down. We're going to kill you and your family. Folks, I was sweating. I was scared. And so then I got distracted. I didn't go to the church, and I went home, and I was doing something. I don't know if I was typing a newsletter, and I'm just bombarded. Don't send out this mailing. These people are going to destroy you. And folk, I said, I'm not going to live that way. And I got down on my knees, and I said, Lord, you have not given me the spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind. And I said, Lord, I'm not getting off my knees until I have your peace. And the devil comes back in and he says, don't do this. You're going to get destroyed if you do it. And I said, Lord, banish that garbage from my brain because you have given me the spirit of love, of power, and of a sound mind.
Amen.
And I said, Lord, thank you that you are greater than anything in this world. And folk, got up off my knees, headed straight to the church, filled up my van with the trays to mass mail Eustis, Florida, and went right down and mailed it. And we've been mass mailing ever since.
Amen.
Folk, we cannot be paralyzed by fear. We can't be. And if we are, we become worthless. What can we do when we're paralyzed? I can't do anything. And this economic crisis, part of this whole thing is to create fear. People are afraid. Am I going to have a job tomorrow? Am I going to be able to go get money out of my bank tomorrow? We're afraid. And so we become paralyzed. And I have a ministry. And when you mass mail books and you send literature all over the world, it costs money. I'm not asking for donations, by the way. I'm making a point. Folk, the point is, when you start to see an economic downturn and you see things really ripping to shreds, the devil just bombards me and says, if you keep sending out that material, you're not going to have any more money, and then you're not going to feed your family, and you're going to be in some cave somewhere. And all of a sudden, you get this paralysis. You say, I can't do anything. I'm afraid. Folks, you're not going to live that way.
Amen.
We can't live that way. Fear cripples you. That's exactly what it does.
You got to step out and pray.
If we have fear, we need to get down on our knees and say, Lord, drive this away. This is not from you. Give me your power to do what you want me to do. Be ye not afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and terrible. Let's see if we can look at a few slides. But what we are experiencing today with financial troubles, this has been going on for throughout American history. It started with the central bank under Morris, then with Hamilton in 1791. The War of 1812 was started and fought because the bank charter was not renewed in 1811. For not renewing the charter for the Central Bank of the United States, a war was fought, blood was shed, people died. A new central bank was started right after the War of 1812. It was started in 1816. So we won the war with Britain, but the Rothschilds and the Jesuit order got exactly what they wanted from the War of 1812. And that was another central bank in America. You see, Thomas Jefferson, Andrew Jackson, several presidents understood that a central bank, a Federal Reserve Bank in the United States, was a greater enemy to the citizens of America than a foreign standing army on American soil. They understood that. Jefferson fought with Hamilton over the establishment of a central bank. Jefferson said, no, no. Jackson did the same. With the reestablishment of the central bank in 1816, Nicholas Biddle was the Rothschild Jesuit agent who manned the central bank. in the United States. There he is on the right, Nicholas Biddle. I'm just going to read some of it. He was a master of the science of money. By the time Jackson came to the presidency in 1828, this is Andrew Jackson, Biddle was in full control of the federal government central bank. This was not the first time a central bank had been established. After the War of 1812, a central bank was tried again. It was in this third attempt that we find Nicholas Biddle. The power that Nicholas Biddle had with the central bank, left-hand column, it says Biddle had one powerful advantage over his adversary, who was Andrew Jackson. For all practical purposes, Congress was in his pocket. More accurately, the product of his generosity was in the pockets of congressmen. Following the Rothschild formula, Biddle had been careful to reward compliant politicians with success in the business world. Few of them would fight the hand, would bite the hand that fed them. Even the great Senator Daniel Webster found himself kneeling at Biddle's throne. Folks, do you know what the time period is for this? Nicholas Biddle came in, headed the central bank in 1816. By 1828, he and Andrew Jackson were about to go head to head. This was during the time when Ellen Harmon had just been born. William Miller had not started preaching yet. But everything was right in the 1820s to create a climate in the world where no man would buy or sell. Because the Rothschilds of Europe had their hands in American finance. They controlled the politicians of America in the 1820s. And America was the last horizon. So before Ellen White was ever known by that name, Revelation 13 was already ready to go in America. She was only a child. William Miller hadn't preached a single sermon. The great disappointment, the Advent movement was 14 years away. The Rothschild Jesuit Consortium was ready for Revelation 13. The almost casualty of Rome was this man right here, Andrew Jackson. Andrew Jackson was not a perfect president. We've never had one. But Andrew Jackson understood one thing, and that was the deadly nature of a central bank in the United States. He did understand that, and he fought it. He almost lost the election of 1832 because he went head-to-head with Nicholas Biddle. Biddle wanted to reestablish the central bank, and he figured that with Jackson coming up for re-election in 1832, that Jackson would not fight it, but Jackson did. This is what Andrew Jackson said about a Federal Reserve or a central bank in America. He said, "Is there no danger to our liberty and independence in a bank that in its nature has so little to bind it to our country? Is there not cause to tremble for the purity of our elections in peace, for the independence of our country in war? Controlling our currency, receiving our public monies, holding thousands of our citizens independence, it would be more formidable and dangerous than a naval and military power of the enemy. Create inflation, create depression, create anything they want." Andrew Jackson won briefly this battle. Andrew Jackson was almost shot for it in 1835. The man who tried to kill him was a man named Richard Lawrence. Lawrence was told, in fact, I'll read it from Griffin's book, it says, "The would-be assassin was Richard Lawrence, who either was truly insane or who pretended to be insane to escape harsh punishment. At any rate, Lawrence was found not guilty due to insanity. He did spend the rest of his life confined to a mental institution. Later, he boasted to friends that he had been in touch with powerful people in Europe who had promised to protect him from punishment should he be caught. You know, I was talking with somebody the other day, and they said, you know, everybody dreams of growing up, of having a family, having a home, having a garden, just living a quiet, peaceful life. And they said, but, you know, when you talk about Bible prophecy, it disrupts all that. It disrupts it. You know, folks, my response to the person was, as a six-year-old child, my world was turned upside down. When my second grade class in San Jose, California, was called to our cafeteria, and we were told by the principal of our school, this was November 22nd, 1963, we were told that the president of the United States had been shot. And I remember seeing the teachers crying. They were crying that day. And I remember that following Sunday, we were ready to go to church. I was going to a Methodist church as a child. And I remember a picture that I believe I saw live on television. It's so vivid in my mind. There were some policemen in plain clothes escorting a man who had been accused of killing the president. And it was in an underground corridor. And he was escorted by all of these plainclothes policemen. And all of a sudden, some people appeared to approach. And I thought it was like newspaper people. And one man stepped out from that group and put a gun in Lee Harvey Oswald's stomach. And he was gone. Folk, that, I will never forget that as long as I live. And then the Vietnam War. And then in the early 70s with Watergate and a president going out in ignominious defeat, not ever coming forth and saying, I blew it, I was wrong, I lied, forgive me, deal with me as you will, I will accept the consequences. Folk, those events in American history, I could not look at American history ever again with rose-colored glasses and say, everything's all right. Because it was not all right. It was not all right. And as I've studied more in history, I realized that what I grew up in the 60s and 70s and 80s, had been going on for over a century. Things in American history have never been right. Never been right, folks, because there has always been a sinister power there to destroy, to suck the blood out of this last bastion of Protestant freedom. They've always been there. The Jesuit order has always been there. The Congress of Vienna in 1814, it was determined by the leaders of Europe in the Holy Alliance that they would turn all their weapons of hell against the United States of America. And they have. During the time of Abraham Lincoln, Otto von Bismarck of Germany stated that the reason the division of the United States into federations of equal force was decided long before the Civil War by the high financial powers of Europe. Who were the high financial powers of Europe? The Rothschilds. And who's behind the Rothschilds? The Jesuit order. So long before the Civil War was fought, the Jesuit Rothschild Consortium of Europe got together and said, we've got to split that nation in two. These bankers were afraid that the United States, if they remained in one block and as one nation, would attain economic and financial independence, which would upset their financial domination over Europe and the world. Of course, in the inner circle of finance, the voice of the Rothschilds prevailed. The rupture between the North and South became inevitable. The masters of European finance employed all their forces to bring it about and turn it to their advantage. By the way, Otto von Bismarck had several attempts made on his life because he opposed the influence of the Jesuit order in the German Empire. That's a fact of history. Otto von Bismarck knew what he was dealing with. Abraham Lincoln, he paid the ultimate price because he dared to oppose the Rothschild Consortium that wanted to hoist foreign money on Lincoln and the United States. Because he refused, one of the reasons, he was gunned down by John Wilkes Booth. So Jackson almost was killed. Lincoln was killed. Who's going to be next? Anybody that stood in the way of a central bank in America? They got it. Lincoln had to go. This is a statement from Charles Chiniquy's book, Two Statements, where Lincoln shows he understood fully who was behind the Civil War. In fact, Lincoln said on this side, he said, we have proof that the company which had been selected and organized to murder me when I passed through Baltimore was led by a rabid Roman Catholic called Byrne. It was almost entirely composed of Roman Catholics. More than that, there were two disguised priests among them to lead and encourage them. I saw Mr. Morse, the learned inventor of electric telegraphy. He told me when he was in Rome not long ago, he found out the proofs of the most formidable conspiracy against this country and all its institutions. Samuel Morse wrote two books, folks, before the Great Disappointment. Samuel B. Morse, the famous inventor of electric telegraphy, wrote two books warning America before the Great Disappointment of what Rome was plotting to do against this country. One was called Foreign Conspiracy Against the Liberties of the United States Through Foreign Immigration. Interesting book. I have a copy of that. The other one is Foreign Conspiracy Against the Liberties of the United States. Two books. One was published in 1835. The other was published in 1844. Samuel B. Morse was a brilliant man. Not only excellent with electronic and other things that had to do with mechanical inventions, he was an excellent painter, but he also understood history, folks. Morse understood history. Abraham Lincoln understood who was behind the Civil War. They all had something in common. James Madison's America opposed the central bank in the War of 1812 ensued. Jackson tried to close the bank and an attempt was made to kill him. Lincoln opposed the money power that sought to destroy the Union and was shot for it. Who was going to be next? The Titanic of 1912. John Jacob Astor and his wife. Isidore Strauss and his wife. There were many, many more. Benjamin Guggenheim, along with Astor and Strauss, were among the many wealthy that died on the maiden voyage of the Titanic. They all have one other thing in common, other than that they died on the Titanic. The Titanic was a death ship. And we get the idea it's all about Leonardo DiCaprio and that lady. It's romanticized. It's glorified. It's Hollywoodized. The Titanic was a death ship, folks. Make no mistake about it. Because 4 years before the Titanic sailed, right at the time it was being built in the shipyards of Belfast in Ireland, J.P. Morgan, the Rockefellers, the Rothschilds, all international financiers, with the Rothschilds at their head and the Jesuits overseeing it all, met at an island off the coast of Georgia called Jekyll Island. And at Jekyll Island, Georgia, right around 1906, 1908, they met there to decide how they would bring upon the American people a central bank. Because since the time of Andrew Jackson, America had not had one. And so the Titanic was built. And the wealthy people that opposed the setting up of a new central bank in America died on the Titanic. John Jacob Astor was the wealthiest man in the world, except for the Pope. They all opposed the plans for the Federal Reserve Bank. Three of the richest and most important of these were Benjamin Guggenheim, Isidore Strauss, and John Jacob Astor. Their total wealth at that time using dollar values was more than $500 million. Today that amount would be nearly $11 billion. These three men were coaxed and encouraged to board the floating palace. They had to be destroyed because the Jesuits knew they would use their wealth and influence to oppose a Federal Reserve Bank as well as the various wars that were being planned. That's from Vatican Assassins by Eric Phelps. What happened after the Titanic sunk? The Federal Reserve Act was passed. Mission was accomplished. Federal Reserve Bank, as we know today, was passed a year and a half after the sinking of the Titanic. 2.25 years after the Titanic, World War I began. A few years later, a graduated income tax was set up in America, and the Bolshevik Revolution was also funded by the Federal Reserve Bank of the United States. You say, how could that be? The communists of the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia were funded by the Republican government of the United States through the Federal Reserve Bank? How could it be? Because the people that were guiding Lenin and Stalin and Trotsky to create the Bolshevik Revolution and take over the Tsar in Russia, and those who controlled the Federal Reserve Bank in the United States, was one and the same. That's how. That's why. Because the people that man the Federal Reserve Bank, they're not Americans. They're not Americans, folks. The Federal Reserve Bank is not under the auspices of the United States government. It's not. It is a totally independent, separate entity. It does what it wants, when it wants, when it's told to do it. Ben Bernanke is not working for us. Neither was Greenspan. Neither was Paul Volcker. They're not working for America. In summation of the Titanic, Rothschild Jesuit agent J.P. Morgan built the Titanic. It was a part of his fleet of ships called the White Star Line. J.P. Morgan was considered an American financier, but the truth of the matter is that J.P. Morgan's dad, J.P. Morgan Sr., had gone bankrupt in England in the 1850s. Forever after that, J.P. Morgan's family was under the control of the Rothschilds because the Rothschilds saved them from bankruptcy. Jesuit Francis Brown, a Jesuit priest, took pictures of the wealthy people who boarded the Titanic. And just before it started out to sea, Francis Brown got off. Edward Smith, who had worked 25 years for J.P. Morgan, captained ships across the Northern Atlantic for 25 years. J.P. Morgan was his mentor and his boss. Despite 8 warnings, Edward Smith went full speed ahead. It's interesting, even the encyclopedias say they don't know what happened to Smith's mind that night. They cannot explain the fact that a veteran for that many years would need 8 warnings to slow the ship down. So why would a veteran of 26 years going across the North Atlantic need to be warned 8 times to slow the ship down? Why? He shouldn't have had to have been warned once. And why didn't he respond and slow the ship down? Because he was on a mission. Smith did as his masters told him, sink it. One man, Morgan Robertson, wrote about the sinking of the Titanic 14 years before it happened. In 1898, Morgan Robertson wrote a book. I have a copy of it. It's called The Futility or The Sinking of the Titan. The length of the ship, the number of lifeboats on the ship, the number of compartments in the ship. So many similarities you find in Robertson's book that was written in 1898 that are basically identical to the Titanic that was sunk in 1912. Ellen White said that Rome is far-reaching in her plans and modes of operation. The next casualty to the money power was Lewis T. McFadden. He was the head of the Finance Committee. This is what this noble American man had to say in the 1920s. He said, Mr. Chairman, we have in this country one of the most corrupt institutions the world has ever known. I refer to the Federal Reserve Board and the Federal Reserve Banks, herein called the Fed. The Fed has cheated the government of these United States and the people of the United States out of enough money to pay the nation's debt. The depredations and iniquities of the Fed has cost enough money to pay the national debt several times over. This evil institution has impoverished and ruined the people of these United States, has bankrupted itself, and has practically bankrupted our government. It has done this through the defects of the law in which it operates, through the maladministration of that law by the Fed, and through the corrupt practices of the moneyed vultures who control it. Lewis T. McFadden understood, folks. He understood. He said the Federal Reserve Bank are a bunch of vultures that are trying to bankrupt this country. He goes on. He served as chairman of the House Committee on Banking and Currency from 1920 to 1931. He fought it with everything he had. Because of that, there were 2 attempts on his life, a failed shooting and an apparent poisoning that made him violently ill after attending a political banquet in Washington. He was murdered in 1936 on a visit to New York City and was interred in East Canton Cemetery. With so many attempts on McFadden's life, one would wonder who was out to get him. Some have speculated that he was targeted because of his opposition to the Federal Reserve System. Andrew Jackson, Abraham Lincoln, Astor, Guggenheim, Strauss, and other wealthy men, Louis T. McFadden. Who would be next? Who would oppose the Jesuit power in a central bank and whose life would be snuffed out as a result? There he is, November 22, 1963, Dealey Plaza, Dallas, Texas. John Fitzgerald Kennedy. John Kennedy was killed in Dealey Plaza, Dallas. One of the reasons was, from James Bo Greitz's book called To Serve, Profiles in Conspiracy, he said when Kennedy called for a return of America's currency to the gold standard and the dismantling of the Federal Reserve System, he actually minted non-debt money that does not bear the mark of the Federal Reserve. And he dared to actually exercise the leadership authority granted him by the U.S. Constitution. Kennedy prepared his own death warrant. It was time for him to go. So what else is new? The War of 1812, Andrew Jackson, Abraham Lincoln, wealthy objectors to the Federal Reserve die aboard the Titanic, Congressman McFadden, John Kennedy, all opposed the Jesuit Rothschild plan to gain absolute control the financial fabric of Protestant America, so that she could be used to bring the world on some distant day to a decision. To a decision. The choice is ours. That no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark of the name of the beast or the number of his name. This crisis has been created by the papacy. To make it bad enough, to make it hurt enough in this country so that America will cry out for a solution. And through heaven's eyes, we know what that solution is. And in response to the Sunday solution of the New World Order of the papacy, heaven will pour out the latter rain. Heaven will pour out the latter rain. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Let's go forward in faith, folk, and do the work God has called us to do. Let's kneel for prayer. Father in heaven, thank you. Thank you for the more sure word of prophecy that shines as a light in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star rises in our hearts. Thank you that through the light of prophecy, Father, we don't have to be deceived by what's going on in our world today. We thank you for the light from the books of Daniel and Revelation. We thank you for the light from the spirit of prophecy through great controversy in other books that shed light on our days. And we thank you for the abundant hope, the abundant hope that we have, that when we get down on our knees and we pray for a power out and above ourselves that we don't have inherently within us, and we cry out for the power of the third person of the Godhead, that he will come to us with mighty power to do what we can't do, to destroy the paralysis of fear so that we can do the work that you've called us to do. Father, bless us with that spirit to do your work in this world, to share your messages with every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, that your waiting children in those fallen and other churches may come out and receive the glorious light of the three angels' messages. Strengthen us to do that work, though the heavens fall. In Jesus' name.